I just realized it's actually hard to smile after after this film, and I watched it. I didn't saw it for half a year, I guess, and I felt okay. It's time to watch it again because when you see a film that you did on your own with a complete strange audience of strangers, then it's very interesting because you start to think, what do they think of the film, and you know what are they making out of it, and so you actually. You discover things that you've never seen before. That it's that's an interesting thing. I'll just stop for it.
其实我觉得一开始看完这部片，发现其实很难笑，因为议题是非常沉重的。那其实我大概有半年没有看这部电影了，那我觉得说我应该要再重看一次，而且也是因为跟一个完全陌生的观众一起观赏这部电影，有一个非常特别有趣的感觉，是因为我可以知道，你们的想法是什么，你们的反应是什么，会去发掘出一些新的面向，对我来讲是非常有趣的。
So, but regarding your question, it's like I mean, the basic idea, like, you know, the first 10 minutes, the premise, and then, of course, the main idea, I would say, to jump ahead 2 years and to see a couple that's, you know, that went through something very terrible, but actually trying to stay together, to live a normal life, to discover intimacy again. That was something that, for me, I felt it was very strong, a very strong subject, and... And even though the beginning is very dark, also a very positive subject, or of course, you know, something about strength, about you know, the will to live, the will for a relationship, and to and life goes on. And although I didn't experience, for God's sake, something like this, I heard stories that were not as similar as shown in the film, but. Kind of it, or where things didn't went, you know, the worst possible way, but that inspired me also. But I think the main idea was like to say life goes on, and how can you know how does life look like when it goes on.
关于主持人问题，我想要回答是，就是大家可以在就是看到前面十分钟的开场之后呢，就跳到两年之后这一对夫妻的故事。那我想要看到的是，就算他们在经历这么大的创伤之后，却仍然能够继续在一起，继续试着过正常的生活，继续维持他们亲密的关系。那对我来讲，这是一个很强情绪很强的议题。虽然他的开场，他的开场是黑暗的，不过也是有正面的讯息，因为他也传达了一种。想要去生存的力量，想要维持关系的力量，以及人生要继续走下去这种携手的力量。那当然，很庆幸是我没有经历过男女主角经历的这样的一个过程，但是我有听过一些类似的故事，虽然没有这么极端，可是非常的接近。那这也启发了我决定去想要去探索，就是当人生经历了这么大的创伤之后，会怎么继续。
Well, I wrote the screenplay, and I mean, what might be interesting, for some reason, it felt easier to write Liv's character for me than to write Malte's character, because I think personally I was kind of, you know, I was actually amazed by my own character or about the strength that she actually. Says okay, or I mean, what she says when at the barbecue, you know, like okay, we didn't do anything wrong, it's nobody's fault. And actually, when I did research and I talked to people or actually victims of assaults, somebody told me when talking about revenge or justice, somebody said to me, I think the best revenge is not to take revenge. You just make sure that you're having a wonderful life.I mean, of course, you can. You know, it's everybody's own opinion what to think of that. But it moved me, and I think it's the kind of a narrative that she has for herself to move on and to look for the good things in life and not to blame herself or even her partner that something wrong happened. Writing Malte felt a little bit more difficult because maybe. He's a more negative kind of person that he he still thinks he's guilty. Well, as a writer, I would say he's not, but he thinks he should have done something, and now that he meets him again, now I will do things right. So I don't know. Today you would say it's a kind of a toxic masculinity that's driving him. So he really wants to do something right now, but actually he's making things worse. You know, by entering the flat, by meeting them again, by telling his girlfriend. That's not very reasonable. But so I think it's for me it was tougher to write him. Yeah, because he's not as grown up as she is, in my opinion.
我觉得很有趣的是我在写这两个角色的时候，我觉得写女主角 Liz 比写男主角 Malt 还来的容易很多，因为某种程度上我对女主角她所展现力量就深感感到非常的惊艳，印象深刻。像是他们在烤肉的那一段，他女主角就说到他知道没有人做错什么事，这个意外不能怪任何的人。那我在做研究的时候，准备这个剧本的时候呢，我也跟了一些性侵的受害者谈过。那他们就关于聊到复仇这件事情时候，就有人说，其实最好的复仇就是继续试着把自己的人生过好，过得美好。那我在写男主角Malt的时候，反而觉得是最困难的，因为他其实是一个比较负面的角色。那他一直以来都觉得他就是深受罪恶感所苦，他一直觉得他应该做某些事情改善这个情况。而当他看到了加害者之后，觉得这是他的机会了。不过某种程度，这也是一个非常有害的男子气概，因为呢，让他进而做更糟糕的决定，像是他进入了加害者的公寓，甚至是告诉他女朋友这些情况等等。所以呢，我觉得写他的角色写起来更困难。
Thank you for mentioning the music. But it's hard to give only one answer to that, because it really it's kind of a mixture of a lot of things that happened during the editing. His profession being a music teacher was there from the beginning, and I totally liked the idea that the music his students bring to the class actually will follow him through his journey. That's, you know, just an idea I really loved. You know, in the end, I think it's only the Beethoven moment where you really can feel that. But I had this idea to have, you know, these, and actually it's a karaoke bar, so to have music there that follows the people through their journey. Actually, my first idea was to only have these kind of source music that the score of the film, the music of the film, is rooted at these moments where it's actually happening in the scenes. But then I pretty early I realized during editing that it would be good to have a score as well to guide the audience to sometimes make it maybe more a bit more of a thriller sometimes.
谢谢你提到音乐这个面向。那其实很难只给单一个答案，因为其实很多因素综合起来的。那像是主角他本身是音乐老师，就有很大的关系。像学生把这音乐带到他的课程，学生带的音乐也某种程度跟着他进入他的旅程。那卡拉 OK 那一段呢的音乐，也是有点像是反映了唱歌者的或者是主角的心境，跟着他们一起走过这段旅程。那其实我一开始的想法，我是想要把我电影里面用的所有的歌都是反映出主角的心境的，不过后来我觉得还是需要一些没有歌词的配乐，那可以引导观众进入到一个另外一种的情绪，比较可以营造出一个悬疑感。
And what I forgot, I mean, the reason behind that idea that, you know, the music from his classroom is guiding him through his life, I like the idea that in his head there is still something terrible, or this longing for vengeance, but the music brings in a kind of a normality. You know, it's like the same thing for life goes on for him as well, but he's not really attached to the life that is going on. He's still attached to what happened 2 years ago and still wants to do something about it.
我很喜欢就是音乐在教室放音乐那一段的时候，是因为 即使就是他即使男主角他还是想着一些他想要复仇，可是音乐带给他一个想要把他拉回一种正常的感觉，想要他人生继续。不过呢，他在听音乐的同时有一种抽离感，因为他的脑袋虽然音乐在播放着，但是他的脑海中仍然想着两年前发生的那场悲剧。
Well, I'm a teacher's child, and I think in a different life I would become a teacher as well. And so I felt kind of that I, you know, that I can tell something about this kind of work. But of course, I also like the fact that they are. Well, on one hand, they are kind of reflected people. They think about human behavior. They have to deal with it every day. And basically, they believe that people are good, that, you know, from a bad pupil, you can, you know, when you teach him or she, you know, they might become a good pupil. That's what they believe. And it just felt interesting for me to confront them with, you know, with this... With this assault, with something really bad happening.
我自己也是老师的儿子，所以呢，另外我觉得如果在另我走人生，我人生如果朝另外一个方向走的话，我也可能成为老师。所以我觉得这是一个我很想要从我很想要我觉得很适合以我的角度来讲的切入的方向。那另外一个原因也就是因为身为老师呢，他们常常会去做很多的反思，去思考人的行为以及背后的动机跟原因。那另外也是他们身为老师，他们相信人是可以变好，透过教导指引是可以让人回到正道的。所以更有趣的是就希望他们有这样的心态，但是遇上了这么悲惨的灾难之后会发生什么事。
Well, talking about the very last scene, what do you think?
你觉得呢?
I mean, well, I tried. I mean, of course, the film is dealing with this emotion of anger and the longing for vengeance and revenge. But I mean, that's really for the audience to tell. Maybe not for me. I try to, and in the end, they might have a kind of a vengeance. I mean, for him telling his girlfriend, of course, for her getting physical, grabbing a knife, stabbing him. I try to make this all look not very heroic and not very satisfying. So even when they actually take him to the hospital, you know, of course, there's this nurse asking, well, could you leave your address? And, you know, where everything is a little bit weird. Because, yeah, as I said, I don't really think that revenge is satisfying. Maybe the idea of having revenge can be very satisfying, or, you know, you want this. But actually doing it, I'm not so sure. I mean, there's this this saying from these old Westerns, from these American Westerns, when you go for revenge, you gotta dig two graves, and I think that makes sense somehow. So because you know, when you take revenge, you're still involved. You're still not. You didn't drop the case. You're not free. You're still involved in something, and I think the goal is to become free and not to solve something. You know, by digging it, in the past. And but maybe I'll just have a break and.
I 我觉得可能某种程度上是一个复仇，因为他也跟加害者女朋友说了这件事，然后最后女主角也用刀捅了加害者一刀。但是我不想要让最后的结局变得很像英雄式般的结束，然后给大家一种给他们或给大家一种满足感，尤其是在医院当个医护人员给他们要问他们要留地址的时候，那种尴尬的感觉就是呈现给其实这个结尾其实并不是让人满足的，复仇不是给人一种满足感的，或许复仇的想法。是，但是行动的话我认为很难说，而且就有一个旧时的西部的说法，就说其实如果你要复仇的话，你要先准备挖好两个坟墓，所以 复仇本身呢，它并不会解放你，让你自由。因为如果你是最后要去放下一切自由的话，去解决一件事情的话，复仇没有办法，复仇是没有办法让你达到这个目的。
And again, talking about this very last scene, to be honest, for a long time, I didn't know how to end this film, and.And I mean, because I mean, the film is kind of, you know, it's trying all kinds of possible ways to deal with this tragedy. You know, it's addressing forgiving someone. It's addressing going to a lawyer like the justice. It's addressing having some kind of revenge, direct or indirectly. It's also addressing the fantasy for her, for example.Okay, if I would find another partner, you know, who is not involved in all this, would things be easier? So for me, it feels like the film is thinking of all these possible ways, and none of them is really satisfying. And originally, the script ended with the moment where they drop in at the hospital, they come home, and they start to tidy up their flat, and that was the end. So like they try to put everything in order, but it felt like a very sad, maybe even more sad ending than this one. And the first time I met Maximilian Brückner, the main actor, he told me, we just met for a beer and we were discussing the script, if he would be like to be involved in this project. And he said to me, well, Sven, I love this script, but there's something missing in the end. And I knew he was right.And then he came up with the idea. Okay, imagine they come home and we were sitting in this bar and we had two glasses of beer, and imagine they come home and one grabs the beer and he throws it on the wall, and then the other one does the same, and so they destroy their whole flat. And I thought, oh damn, I have to cast this person now, because this idea is really good. And but I mean, basically, it was a good idea to have him play that part, of course. And yeah, I wrote that in the script because I think that was something I was looking for, but I didn't found it, because for me, it feels, to answer your question finally, to me, it feels revealing. It's a new beginning. It is something spectacular that has nothing to do with the plot, you know, with the assault, with.Meeting him again and everything like that. It's something, it's a part of a new life they might have.
其实我很长一段时间我都不知道该怎么给这部电影一个结尾，因为在电影当中因为有可能这角色们可能有很多种方法去解决这个问题，像是去找律师啊，或者是用直接或间接的方式复仇，或者是女主角她也想要试着找一个跟整件事件都没有关系的男生，然后可能或许有一段暧昧的关系这样。所以但是这些选择都没有一个是让我可以满足的，而且一开始的一个结尾结束的方式就是他们从医院回到家之后开始动手整理公寓。那其实这样的结束在情绪上甚至比现在这个结局还来得更难过。那会有现在的结局呢，就来到我第一次跟男主角 Maximilian 碰面的时候，那时候我们就一起喝啤酒，然后讨论剧本，想要问他有没有兴趣加入。那他觉得这剧本很好，但是呢总觉得结局缺了什么东西，所以他就提了一个想法。他说要不要让这一对夫妻他们回家的时候，一个人就拿起一个酒瓶然后砸向墙壁，然后另外一个人也跟着这样做，然后最后他们就是砸毁整个他们的公寓。然后当下听到觉得真的这个想法太好了，决定就是当然他就要演男主角，而且要把这个想法加入电影，因为这是我一开始在写的时候完全没有想到的一个想法。因为对男女主角来讲都是一个释放，而且是一个新的开始，而他们的举动跟之前的这个攻击是完全无关的，而就是一个新生活，象征新生活开始的一个动作。
哦，非常谢谢导演跟我们如此详尽跟慷慨的分享，那也很谢谢大家今天再来看这场金马影展。
Thank you.